Hi everyone, today at the seminar we are hosting Krzysiek Kleiner. Krzysiek, please start.
Thank you very much for the invitation. Hello everyone, my name is Krzysztof Kleiner, I'm from the Jagiellonian University, and today I will talk a bit about something which originally started as an idea that my supervisor Lech Duraj had for my master's thesis, but in the end it became a paper under these four names, and it became my master's thesis too. So this paper is in the field of the fine-grained complexity. I presume most of you are familiar with this topic, so I'll only give like a really, really short overview. I'll not give a full introduction to this topic. So the idea behind fine-grained complexity is to mimic the behavior similar to, let's say, NP completeness inside the class of polynomially solvable problems. So, for example, let's assume we have some problem which we can solve, I don't know, in n square times, and we don't know any algorithm which solves it faster. So in some cases we might be able to prove unconditionally a lower bound, to like prove that this problem cannot be solved faster, but that's pretty rare. Usually we're not able to achieve such unconditional lower bounds. But what we can do is we can try to trace the hardness of our problem into something which is already well studied, which kind of mimics the NP hardness thing. Because if we're proving an NP hardness of some problem, then we haven't actually proven that this problem is hard. Like maybe it is still solvable in polynomial time. We don't know this because we don't know whether P equals NP. But what we have done is we have traced the hardness of our problem into some hypothesis, in that case P versus NP, which is very well known, very well studied, and we don't expect that a simple research on our particular problem could solve P versus NP. So this is kind of a conditional lower bound, like tracing the hardness of the problem into something well known. And the idea of fine-grained complexities is to do the same inside the P class. So for example, here I presented the free sum hypothesis. I think most of you are familiar with it. That's one of the hypotheses. If we have such hypotheses, we can use them as hardness assumptions for proving the hardness of other problems. And then we can say that our problem, it doesn't maybe have an unconditional lower bound, but it has a conditional lower bound on that free sum hypothesis. Like we cannot solve it faster than currently known by a polynomial factor unless the free sum hypothesis does not hold. So that's the basic idea. And in particular, we can talk in this setting about some problems being fine-grained equivalent. And we have two possible ways of proving this, and let's very quickly go through this. Like this is the, like, let's say, most general definition, somewhat simplified because I already assumed that those problems have the same conjectured running time, but that's like a simplification. But the idea in this definition is that we say that problems are fine-grained equivalent if for every epsilon there exists such delta that finding an algorithm faster by a polynomial factor of epsilon for one of the problems would imply an algorithm which solves the other problem also polynomially faster when this polynomial factor is delta for the other problem, and vice versa. If both of these reductions hold, we say that problems are fine-grained equivalent. And there is a special case when we can just not use a conjectured running time, this conjectured lower bound, but we can just prove unconditionally that if a problem can be solved in some time, t of n, then the other problem can also be solved in the same time up to sub polynomial factors, and vice versa. And of course, this second possibility is more desirable because, let us say, if we prove the equivalences in this more general way, then actually what happens is that these problems turn out to be equivalent with respect to our current state of knowledge. Like, as long as our conjecture training bounds hold, then the problems remain equivalent. But if by some chance it happened that actually we are able to improve one of our problems, then yeah, it all means the other problem can also be improved, but they are no longer equivalent afterwards because this epsilon and this delta are different. So those columns cease to be equivalent. So that's kind of an equivalence, which we might argue is not like an objective property of those problems, but which is like only true with respect to our current state of knowledge. While if we prove the equivalence in this more precise meaning, just up to subpolynomial factors, then no matter what our lower bounds are, those problems truly are equivalent up to subpolynomial factors. So this is like more desirable as long as we are able to actually make proofs in this way. And the special case of this situation is we can just prove the equivalence up to polylogarithmic factors. And for this reason, we have this simplification of the notation. Weak O means that these running times are like meet the same definition as for the general O notation up to polylogarithmic factors. That's how we will be proving the reductions in this paper. So that's the basic overview. The basic idea will be to prove some equivalences which are true up to polylogarithmic factors, and then no matter what the conjectured lower bounds are, because in some cases we will not be exactly meeting them, so that's why this distinction is important, will not always be actually meeting the lower bounds, but our reductions will not depend on it. They will be like those true objective equivalences up to polylogarithmic factors. Okay, so that was a very, very brief overview of the fine-grained complexity. I'll not go much more into the details, but now let's move to our topic. So the question from which we started, and that's one of the questions we answered, although I guess in the general scheme of things, that's maybe not the most interesting one, but that's the one when we started. Range inversions query, a problem when we are given an array of integers and a sequence of some ranges, some intervals queried. And for each of those intervals, we want to compute the number of inversions in this interval, that is the elements which are out of order in this interval. And this is a problem which is very well known to anybody who did any competitive programming, because it is always used as an introduction to the two techniques, square root decomposition and Mohs algorithm technique. But of course, it's just an example of a problem on the intervals of a range query problem, where we can just say we are just given an array of integers, some sequence of ranges, and we want to compute some quantity for each of those intervals. And the thing about range query problems is some of them are well researched, some specific instances. The most well known of them is the RMQ, range minimum query, which is solvable in a near linear time using segment trees, but still there's a lot of research about how to do it better, faster. But there was no research about the range query problems in general. And if we want to consider the range query problems in like more higher generality, then range inversions query seems to be a good starting point. Why? Because we don't know any algorithm which would be near linear. Like we're not able to solve it using segment trees in like n log n or n log square n. We don't know such algorithms. We have these two algorithms which have similar running times, and the worst case when we treat it as a function of a single parameter is n square root n. because like sometimes we might want to consider our problems as being defined by two parameters, n, the number of elements, and q, the number of queries. But if we actually want to consider the worst case complexity, then the parameter which we care about is the length of the input, which is n plus q. So the worst case situation is when those two parameters are equal, because otherwise, if n is smaller than q, then we could just add some dummy elements to the array for which we will never query, and the input size will blow at most twice, so the complexity will not change. Consequently, if q is smaller than n, then we can add some dummy queries. The input size blows at most twice, so the complexity doesn't change. So overall, the worst complexity is achieved in this special case of n equal q, and it equals to n square root n. At least that's what we know. But is it possible to find some faster algorithms? We don't know. Like we just we're not knowing anything better. But let's try to analyze this problem. So first, some really, really easy observations. If we are able to solve this range inversion square root problem, then we can also solve its equivalent on the pairs of intervals. So now, instead of asking about some quantity on a single interval, we're asking about a pair of intervals, and we want to know the number of pairs of elements such that the left range element is larger than the right range element. And to solve it using the range inversion query, we're using this super standard trick which everybody has seen many times. Like we're taking this range with plus, minus this, plus this, and what remains is the result for the pair of those intervals. So yeah, that's easy, that's standard. The other very easy thing which we can say is if we're able to be finding the number of inversions, that is the elements such as the left element is larger than the right element, then we can also find the number of the equal pairs in the interval, because an equal pair is just a pair such that neither the left element is larger than the right element, nor vice versa. And both of those things we can compute using our range inversions. What remains is the number of the equal pairs in the interval. And of course, the same as here, we can reduce this normal instance to this double interval instance. The arrows here, I'm pointing in the direction of the reduction. So like if we can solve this column, then we can solve this column. So the reduction is from here to here. That's the direction that I'm using on those charts. And now what we can notice, another easy observation, is if we are able to solve this problem, that is the problem we have a queries about pairs of intervals, and for each pair, we want to know the number of pairs of equals elements in those two intervals. Then we can solve the problem of triangle counting. This is the problem to compute the number of triangles, that is clicks on three vertices, in some given graph. How do we do this? Really simple. We're just creating an array where we concatenate the neighbor lists of all vertices. And now suppose that, for example, in the graph, there exists an edge from vertex 0 to vertex 2. Then in order to know how many vertices there are containing this particular edge from 0 to 2, we just need to ask a query. How many pairs of equals elements are there in this part and in this part of the input? And each such pair is one element which is connected to this vertex, which is connected to this vertex. And since we're only asking this for the vertices which are connected by an edge, this is a triangle. So we have reduced our problem to m queries over an array of length 2m. So that's pretty nice, that's pretty easy, and that's pretty useless. Because if we wanted to use those observations in order to find some lower bound, then there's nothing to do because there are no interesting lower bounds known for triangle counting. If we wanted to use those reductions in order to solved the triangle counting using some algorithm for the range query problems, then we're also out of luck because the complexity for the triangle counting is better than for the range queries. For range queries, as I said, the worst case complexity is n square root n. Triangle counting, we can solve it using just the fast matrix multiplication for dense graphs. For sparse graphs, we have this slightly more complicated Alon Euster-Zwick algorithm, which still uses the fast matrix multiplication and achieves such a running time. Of course, this dense sparse thing is like an intuition. Formally, the running time is just minimum of those two numbers, but the intuition is, of course, that for dense graphs, this algorithm is better. For sparse graphs, this algorithm is better.
Can I ask you about specific detail, because you just said about a reduction from triangle counting to those query problems. Mm-hmm. But how does it preserve the parameters?
It doesn't. It's for this case of an equal Q.
Yeah. So what type of instance do you get from a typical triangle counting instance?
Get an instance of M queries in an array of length 2M. So like up to some dummy queries. This is basically an instance with N equal Q, and both of them are equal to 2M.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah. So that's a specific instance, but that's the one instance which is actually most interesting because that's the actual worst case. So if all those problems are considered as problems defined by one parameter, the input length, then this is exactly this instance which we are getting here. This is the worst case instance. So that's nice. Yeah. So still, as I said, we can't say anything overly interesting from this because those complexities are better than this complexity. So we really don't have anything interesting yet, but what we've seen is that this two-range equal pairs query problem, that is the problem of finding the number of pairs of equals elements, is some kind of a window from our range query world into something which is already well researched, into the triangle problems, which are already established in the research. So now what we would like to do is, first, we would like to say that this problem could be treated as some kind of a stand-in for some broader class of the range query problems. So what we would like to do is first to reverse those dependencies which we've already established, like to turn them into equivalences, and also maybe add some other functions so that we don't only talk about the range query problems and EQPers query problems, but just those inversion predicate and this equal pairs predicate. We can just generalize them into some functions taking two arguments, and we can just lift such a function into the range F pairs query problem. And then the specific instances would be those two I already mentioned, the inversions and the equal pairs. So are we able to find some such functions that we would be able to prove an equivalence with this problem? Yes, it turns out we can. I will not go much into the details of this proof because it's quite technical, but there's this nice framework by Przemysław Uzdański, our host, and Karim Labib and Daniel Graf, which defines the non-axis orthogonal piecewise polynomial functions. What this definition basically says, it's those functions which consist of a sum of some number of if statements, where one part of the if statements, like one half plane, is zero, and the other half plane gets us this polynomial factor. And when we combine a lot of such half plane equations, for each of them we find a polynomial function, then the overall sum of those terms is piecewise polynomial, and it's non-axis orthogonal piecewise polynomial if at least some of those half-plane equations are not parallel to the axis. So there are some examples of non-axis orthogonal piecewise polynomial functions. We have inversions here, some rectifier function, distance, etc. There's quite many nice simple functions which can be expressed this way. And we can prove that for any non-axis orthogonal piecewise polynomial function with polylogarithmically many summands in it, we can actually produce an equivalence to range AQ per square, our canonical problem. So as I said, I will not go into the details of the proof, but the very basic intuition behind this is that this framework provides us a way to decompose and recompose these non-axis orthogonal piecewise polynomial functions in terms of some building blocks, which are some reasonably bounded number of functions, which are the functions of single parameter, and just two functions taking two parameters, which are very simple. One of them is multiplying the arguments, and the other is checking whether the arguments are equal or not. And all the rest are the functions of one parameter. And what we can do is we basically lift this framework, those equations resulting from this framework, into the world of the range queries. Because all of those terms which are related to the functions of a single parameter, that's easy for us, because we can just compute those functions for any value appearing in our array. We wouldn't be able to do this if a function was a function of two parameters, because then we would have n squared computations to perform to compute all of those results. But thanks to the decomposition into functions of a single parameter, we can just compute all those results, store them in an array, and perform some range queries. And what remains is to be able to handle those two building blocks, of which one is exactly this, the number of equal pairs of equal elements, and the other is the multiplication, which is very easy to perform on the intervals. So there is a lot of technicalities when we dig deep down, but basically the idea is to lift this whole framework by Labi-Puzynski and Graf into the range query problems. And then we can see that all those columns from which we started and all range f per query problems for a function f, which is non-axis orthogonal piecewise polynomial, they are all fine-grained equivalent. So great, so we have an equivalence class, and we have a triangle counting problem, which reduces to this class. But as I said, the triangle counting problem is not that interesting for us because it doesn't provide us any interesting lower bounds. But what we can notice is when we're showing this reduction from the triangle counting to the range query problems, then what we actually did, we solved another problem. We solved a problem where for every edge from the graph, we want to count the number of triangles containing this particular edge. And it might look like it's quite artificial to distinguish these two problems, but as we will see, actually, it might be much better to treat this version of the triangle counting as, let's say, canonical form rather than this original one. So let us see what we can do if we analyze this particular version of the triangle counting. So first, let us introduce a problem of triangle listing. This is one of the most famous triangle problems, well studied. In this problem, we are given a graph and a parameter, and we want to find any t triangles in this graph. What I mean to find any t triangles? It means that if there are at most t triangles in this graph, we want to just get returned all those triangles. If the graph contains more than t, then we can return any t out of the triangles in this graph. And this problem has this strange complexities. We will not go into the details, but what is important for us, and also what is like the most like the most famous, I think, version of this problem is the situation when the number of triangles to be listed is equal to the number of edges. Why is that interesting? Because then the upper bound is exactly the same as the time for triangle counting. And yet it is an open question in the field whether those two problems are actually related. Like maybe they're equivalent, or maybe at least we could find a reduction from triangle counting to triangle listing in this version of the equal M. We don't know this. Like, all we know is that those problems look somewhat similar, like they are both about finding the triangles in the graph. But then in one case we only want to count this, and the other case we don't care about all of them, but only about T of them. They have exactly the same running time, quite strange. Of course, it comes down to the fast matrix multiplications algorithm, which are used deep down. But we don't know whether those problems are equivalent or not. And this problem, unlike the previous problem, it has an established lower bound proven by Patrashko, that it requires m times 4/3 under the free sum hypothesis. And those two complexities, they would match if omega was equal to. If omega is equal to, then we exactly get 4 here and 3 here. So what we can do is, instead of going into the triangle counting, we can show how to solve the triangle listing problem if we are able to solve edge triangle counting, because here we already know a lower bound which we can use. And to be a little bit more precise, we will actually show that triangle listing is equivalent to the decision version of our edge triangle counting. What I mean by the decision version, I mean that given a graph, we want to determine for each edge just whether there exists a triangle in this graph which contains this particular edge. And maybe quite surprisingly, those two problems turn out to be equivalent. Why is that so? So the idea, first I'll go from right to left. So we assume now that we are able to prove, that we are able to solve edge triangle detection, and we want to prove that in the same running time, up to polylogarithmic factors, we are able to solve triangle listing. Okay, so that's a graph, and we want to list T triangles in this graph. So first, let us assume that we are given a tripartite graph. So the three partitions of the graph. We choose one of them, let's say this one. And what we will do is we will do a recursive algorithm in which we are splitting this set into two roughly equinormous sets. So in this case, I've split it into two vertices and one vertex. And what we do, for each edge adjacent to those vertices, we keep them in the left copy of the graph. For each edge adjacent to those vertices, we keep it only in the right copy. And for all the other vertices, and for all the edges between those two sets, we're just creating a copy. We have now two copies of this set, two copies of this set, and two copies of the edges between them. So of course, our graph has now larger size than it originally had, at most twice. But what we can now do is, on this whole graph, like those are not two graphs. This is like one graph which has two components. So on this resulting graph, we call edge triangle detection. And what we will learn is that for some of those edges, we only care about the edges between these two sets. So for some of those edges, we will learn that they are not contained in any triangle. So we can safely remove all those edges. And if there are any vertices which become isolated in the process, then we also remove them. So what we are left with is that we have those two copies of the graph without some edges. And for each edge that remains, for each of those edges here at the bottom, for each edge that remains for this and for this, we know that there is at least one triangle which contains this edge. So what can now we do? We just check how many edges were left this way. And is it larger or smaller than the number of triangles that we want to list? So if it's smaller, then we go into the next level of the recursion. So on the next level, we would split this set into those two vertices. While if there is more edges left, then we just remove some of those edges. I won't say randomly because like it's not an randomized algorithm. We just arbitrarily remove some of the edges such that exactly T edges remain here. So what we are left with, and then of course we go deeper into the recursive call. So what happens is that at some point we will split this upper set into the sets of which each has one vertex. And when we have it, then it's very easy to list all the triangles because each of the edges here at the bottom, which is left, will have exactly one vertex candidate in the top part with which it can form a triangle. So then we very easily can list all the triangles. The only question is whether we haven't lost some of the triangles. And of course we did. Of course, when we were removing arbitrarily edges, then we could have lost some triangles. But let us recall that we are doing it in each phase only if at the bottom we had more than T edges. So it means that if originally there was no more than T edges, let us recall the definition. We want to list all the triangles if there are at most T of them, or any T triangles otherwise. So here, what happened is that if there were fewer than T triangles originally, then we never went into this phase of removing arbitrarily edges. While if there were more than T triangles, then we could have lost some triangles in this phase, but every time we were entering this phase, we were guaranteed by the triangle detection that there are at least T other edges out there which are part of the triangle. And since the graph was tripartite, then each time we know that there is a triangle containing this edge, then this is a distinct triangle. Like we cannot have a triangle which contains this edge and at the same time contains this edge. So in the end, what turns out is that it was not possible for us to lose any of the triangles in the process below the number T, this number of the triangles which we actually want to list. And the only thing is we assumed that the graph is tripartite, but that is very easy to handle because when we have our original graph, then we can just create a tripartite graph from it by multiplying all the edges and vertices. And we have a graph in which each triangle has six copies. So then if in such a graph we want to list 60 triangles, then there will be at least T unique triangles among them. So now let us go in the opposite direction.
Why don't you blow up the number of edges in all the instances of the recursion?
Because each time, if there are more than T edges at the bottom, then I am removing arbitrary edges as long as I don't go down back to T. And originally T is equal M up to like, it's actually 6M. So the number of edges originally is 6M. Then I blow them up, but then instantly I remove arbitrarily such edges until I am back down to 6m. And this continues.
So, but you mean below t in all of the instances at the level that you are currently in? Or?
Yes, it's like I wouldn't talk about as instances. Like this is one graph, which originally has one connected component, then it has two connected components, then four connected components. Like each time I have one graph.
Yeah, and that makes sense.
Across this whole graph, I'm removing those edges to keep them down. Okay. So let us go in the opposite direction. This will be a randomized reduction, which is maybe a little bit sad, but in general, in fine grained complexity, the randomized reductions are considered basically as valid as the others because all those hypotheses, they work for the randomized algorithms too. Like we don't know, for example, a randomized algorithm for the free sum, and all those hypotheses include the possibility that, like, the free sum hypothesis says we cannot solve free sum faster, neither by deterministic nor randomized algorithm. So what we do here, I will not go into the computations, but the basic idea is if we are able to list t triangles in the graph and we want to solve triangle detection, then for each s from log m to zero, we will perform such phase when some number of times. Why is it exactly this? It's just results from the computations. Like it's a standard thing. We choose one set, let's say this upper set. Of course, again, we assume that the triangle, that the graph is tripartite. From this upper set, we choose each of the vectors with probability 2^-s. We try to list linearly many triangles and remove all those edges for which the triangles were found. Like those edges go into the output. So that's a very, very simple randomized algorithm. And I will not show the computations, but the idea why it works is that we can have some edges which participate in many triangles. Like for example, this edge here participates in two. So the idea is that in this phase, when the probability is 1 divided by 2^s, we will, with high probability, find all those edges which have many triangles, particularly which have 2^s triangles in them. And if we find them with high probability, then we remove them. And in the next phase, we go into the smaller s, but also we have get rid of all those edges which would most frequently show on the output of the triangle listing algorithm. Because when the triangle listing algorithm produces the triangles, then it could like show us this triangle and many times mention this edge. But the intuition is we get rid of all those edges which would appear frequently on the output, and then we go into the deeper phase. So I will not go into the details, like it needs some computations to see that this actually works, but I hope like the intuition behind this is clear. So
It wasn't clear to me. What do you do with when you choose these vertices? You try to find these triangles in this subgraph?
Yeah, I'm just calling the triangle listing algorithm. I'm looking at the output of all those triangles which appeared. And for each edge in this triangle, like I'm marking this edge as an edge which contains a triangle, and I will not consider this edge anymore.
Okay.
Okay, great. Okay, so what we know now is that, quite interestingly, this edge triangle detection is equivalent to triangle listing. So we haven't still all answered the question, and we won't answer this question, whether triangle counting actually is equivalent to triangle listing. We still don't know it, but it certainly looks like an interesting step in this direction. Like those two problems, triangle counting and edge triangle detection, they are intuitively much easier to compare, like on the intuitive level, than triangle listing and triangle counting. Those are the problems which basically are both an a version of this edge triangle counting problem. So let us summarize from this part what we already know based on this proof. So first, triangle listing has a lower bound based on free sum. So thanks to all those reductions, we can translate this bound from the triangle listing through edge triangle detection counting to all our range query problems, which are equivalent to the range AQ pairs query. So we have this lower bound. The second thing is, what I already said, like we seem to be closer maybe to answering the question, how exactly triangle counting is linked to triangle listing. Maybe that's a step in this direction. And the third conclusion is we have obtained an alternative algorithm for triangle listing, because the Alon-Eustace-Zwick algorithm, which solves triangle counting, when you look at the details, it actually solves edge triangle counting. Like it was not developed in order to solve this problem, because this problem like didn't exist in the research because we decided maybe somewhat artificially to name it. But what the algorithm for triangle counting was doing was it was solving this problem. So using this Alon-Eustace-Zwick algorithm and our reductions, we obtain a significantly different triangle algorithm, which matches the state-of-the-art complexity, despite being like substantially different. It's not like we get a similar approach, but the approach which we obtain is significantly different to this algorithm developed, I think, by Virginia Wasilewska-Williams, if I recall correctly. And from what I shown, we would only have this algorithm for the special T equal M version of the triangle listing. But in order to translate it into all those instances, we're showing this reduction, which I'll not go into because it's a pretty long proof. It's probably the longest proof in this paper. But it basically tells us that if we are able to show triangle listing, to solve triangle listing for this specific version, then we are able to translate such an algorithm into the triangle listing in the general version, like in the black box manner, not assuming anything about this particular algorithm. And these coefficients here are so chosen that if you substituted the Alon-Eustace-Zwick algorithm here, then you get an algorithm for this matching the state of the art complexity. So those are the three conclusions from that part. Now, the other thing which we can show, and I think I will not go into the proof because we're shortly running out of time. We have still, how much time do we have left? Like 15 minutes?
I mean, take as much time as you want.
Okay. So here the idea is, if edge triangle counting, this problem, can be solved in some time, then we can solve range AQ pairs query in this specific instance of Q equal N offline. This is slightly inconvenient, but still interesting, in the same time up to polylogarithmic factors. Maybe I will not go much into the details, but the very basic overview of this proof is, let us assume that we are able to solve triangle counting, and we want to solve the range query problems, searching for the numbers of pairs of equal elements. So basically what we'll do is we will create a tripartite multigraph in this case, where one partitions are the values and the two other partitions are the decomposition of our array into a segment tree. And then the edges are between each value and each interval from the segment tree decomposition. And we also decompose all the queries and create edges between those instances of the intervals appearing in the segment tree, which are part of any of our queries. That's a very basic overview. Like there are some details, like for example, this is a multigraph and we actually have only edge triangle counting algorithm for the graphs. So we need to do some more steps, like basically, again, decomposing these multigraph instances into some not too large number of graph instances, which we actually do basically speaking by decomposing each multiplied edge into its binary decomposition. And then like for each binary digit of each wave, we create a separate simple graph. And when we combine all those simple graphs for all the digits in the binary decomposition of the edge waves, then we can combine it into an algorithm which solves the multigraph instance. And when we can solve the multigraph instance, then we can solve the range queries in the way I said earlier, by creating the decompositions of all the queries into polylogarithmically many intervals resulting from the decomposition into the segment tree. Yeah, so I will not go into all the details, but I hope this overview like gives a feel. This is an easy proof, like quite easy. It just has some technicalities, but what it tells us is that this equivalence class which we started from, all those range F pairs query problems for the non-axis orthogonal piecewise polynomial functions, is actually equivalent to edge triangle counting. What is nice about it is that we now have two equivalence classes, and this only reduction, which is not an equivalence, is the trivial reduction, which says that if we are able to count the triangles for each edge in the graph, then we are also able for each edge to say whether it participates in at least one triangle or not. Yeah, so that's as trivial as it can be, and that's the only reduction which is not an equivalence on this in these two complexity classes. And there is also this reduction, which is a bit to the side, to the min-max product, which is not a tight reduction, but in the current state of knowledge, it still provides us some kind of a lower bound. I'll not go much into it. This is much to the side of everything. This problem, which appeared here, to range in disjoint query, it's just this problem, but taken into the decision variant, the same way that the edge triangle detection is a decision variant of the edge triangle counting. So the proof which I listed in short on the previous slide, like from here to here, it also allows us to relate those two problems, one to another. But back to the main topic, which is the triangle problems and this complexity class. What we can say is that all those problems can be solved in this running time. This is the running time of the Alonius-Terzvik algorithm, which, as I said, can solve edge triangle counting. So thanks to the reduction from here to here, we can use this algorithm to solve all of our equivalent range query problems. And we also generalize it to the online problems and to the problems analyzed as a function of two parameters. So this algorithm is not exactly the same as Alonius-Terzvik algorithm. It's, let's say, a different algorithm solving this problem. So this is maybe in some little bit redundant with what I already said. Like basically we have two ways of obtaining this complexity for our class. Once we can obtain it from Alonius-Terzvik algorithm, and second time we can obtain it as a special case of our algorithm for range a Cooper's query. But in both cases, the bottom line is that that's the complexity for this class and also for this class. And on the other hand, both of these classes have a lower bound of n to the fourth third if unconditionally under the free sum hypothesis, which would match this running time if omega was equal to. So as you can see, we're talking about fast matrix multiplication a lot here. And the question is, what if we would want not to rely on those algorithms? Because of course, as we know, fast matrix multiplication is not extremely practical. So then let us return to the beginning. our range query problems can be solved by Moore's algorithm in such a running time. This is slightly better than the square root decomposition method offline. What about online? I'll not go into this, but we can quite simply generalize Moore's algorithm to the online case using persistent data structures. So that's maybe also not super useful in practice, because we also have the square root decomposition method, which is only slightly works, but we want not to need to consider those two complexities for offline and online separately. So we're just generalizing more into the online case. And can we do faster? Like, we already know that we can do faster using fast matrix multiplication, but what if we don't want to use fast matrix multiplication? Then we can perform a very simple observation that multiplication of two binary matrices can be reduced to our range query problems. Why is that interesting? Because there is such a thing called binary matrix multiplication hypothesis, I put it in quotes, which says that any combinatorial algorithm requires strictly an cubic time to multiply two binary matrices. And the thing with this hypothesis is that it uses this word combinatorial algorithm, which is not well defined. Like, the idea is to capture this undesirable nature of this Strassen-like fast matrix multiplication algorithms. So we basically say that a combinatorial algorithm is an algorithm which doesn't use fast matrix multiplication. So this is, in some sense, this is kind of self-defining, but at least on this like practical level, I think it's quite good to use it. Like, maybe it's not an objective statement, but it tells us that if we wanted to solve our problems faster, then we cannot rely on the fast matrix multiplications algorithm as long as we don't create a combinatorial algorithm for the fast matrix multiplication. And of course, we can say, like, how will we know that an algorithm which we found is combinatorial? It's hard to say for sure, but the assumption is if we find a combinatorial algorithm multiplying the matrices faster, then we will know it. So this is all a little bit slippery, but the bottom line is that most likely the only way to achieve these better results, better than the Moore's algorithm for all of this, is to use fast matrix multiplications, like our algorithm for the triangular counting does, for the range query, AQ pair query does. Same as Alan Euster's Vic algorithm does solving edge triangle counting. And so basically, we are settled in the case when we don't want to use fast matrix multiplication. In case when we want to use fast matrix multiplication, we are also quite settled, because the situation is that this upper bound and this lower bound, they don't actually match. This is about 1.41. This is about 1.33. So that's clearly smaller. But if omega was equal to 2, then our upper bound for both of these complexity classes would match the lower bound. So what does that tell us? Well, it tells us that our lower bound does not exactly match the algorithms we have, but we can't really hope for a better lower bound for our problems. Because if we are able to prove any higher lower bound, then combine this with this, this would constitute the proof that omega is larger than 2. And this is a big open question. Like, maybe one day we will be able to prove that omega is higher than 2, but probably we will not achieve this by analyzing the complexity of the triangle counting problems or the range query problems. So basically, for those problems, it seems like the complexity is settled. Like, any higher lower bound than the one that we already have would be a large breakthrough, like a very desired proof that omega is larger than 2. So this is probably won't happen. This will probably at least not happen this way. Yeah. So it means this complexity landscape is pretty much settled. We have quite a large complexity class for the range queries. And we've done some quite interesting, I believe, progress in like analyzing the triangle world. We started just from analyzing this, but I think actually this part is maybe the more interesting one, because those problems were out there for quite some time. Like the question whether triangle listing is equivalent to triangle counting was open from quite some time. It's still open, but I think we know quite more right now. So there are some open problems here. First, whether the offline and online variants of our range query problems are equivalent, because we have shown those all those equivalences, and the equivalences work both for the offline and online variants. But what I didn't touch in this presentation is the question like whether the offline and online variants only have the same time complexity, or are they actually equivalent? Like this is clearly not the same, although this is a similar statement. And regarding the triangle problems, are those two classes actually distinct? Like we have this large equivalence class, this smaller equivalence class here, and a trivial reduction between them. And both these classes have the same upper bound and the same lower bound. So in principle, there's nothing that would tell us that maybe this is not the same complexity class. In order to prove this, we would need to be able to reverse this reduction between triangle counting and triangle detection. Is it possible? I don't know. Like in principle, it looks like it could be possible. Like we can spare polylogarithmic slowdown in those reductions. So maybe there is some clever way to actually solve edge triangle counting using edge triangle detection using in some clever way this problem many times, like polylogarithmically many times, and solving this, maybe. Or maybe not. We don't know this, but it looks quite interesting. Like if this was actually proven, then this is a really, really nice progress into the question of the triangle listing versus triangle counting. Because if we are able to say that triangle listing for this particular case is equivalent to edge triangle counting, then we are only left with the trivial reduction between edge triangle counting and triangle counting. And that's the last open problem. Like, are those problems equivalent? Like, we can see that edge triangle counting is maybe a better problem to be analyzing, at least in this complexity landscape, compared to the original triangle counting problem. But is it actually easier to solve triangle counting than edge triangle counting, or not? Maybe they are equivalent. And if not, do there exist faster algorithms for the triangle counting? We already know that for edge triangle counting, this is unlikely, because we have this lower bound from free sum to edge triangle counting. But for triangle counting, we don't know. Maybe it's possible to solve it faster. So those are the open problems and out of the scope of our paper, but that's pretty interesting. So I will mention it. I started with saying that maybe focusing on this edge triangle counting problem was somewhat artificial. Like maybe it looked like we did it just because it's useful for our reduction. And that's quite true. But it turns out that actually this problem is maybe much better to analyze. Or this problem, edge triangle detection, is better to analyze. Because after our paper, Virginia Wasilewska-Williams continued this line of research, and she focused on this particular problem, edge triangle detection, which she, I believe, renamed into all edges sparse triangle. And the result here from her paper is pretty interesting, is that this problem is not only hard based on free sum, which we already know from this paper, but it's also hacked based on all pairs shortest paths hypothesis. So what it actually means is, thanks to our reduction between triangle listing and edge triangle detection, triangle listing is now known to be hard under the APSP hypothesis too. It was known since Patrashku proven it, that this problem has a lower bound of n to the 4/3 under the Friesen hypothesis. Now, thanks to Virginia's proof into edge triangle detection and this equivalence, which I've already shown, we can say that exactly the same lower bound is also true based on the APSP hypothesis. That's pretty great, because it means that all our problems mentioned here, but also all the other problems which have already been reduced from triangle listing, whose hardness was already established based on triangle listing, are actually also hard based on the APSP hypothesis, not only the Friesen hypothesis, as we thought. So it looks like maybe it just needed someone to notice that these edge versions of the triangle counting are more interesting to analyze, like we can prove more about them than about just this plain version of triangle counting. I believe this Virginia Wasilewska-Williams result is pretty great, because in the five-grain complexity, like, we don't want to treat those hardness hypotheses as truth. Those are just the assumptions which might turn out false. Like, maybe Friesen hypothesis will turn out false, or APSP hypothesis will turn out false. But due to this, we basically want to track which problem is, for example, only hard based on Friesen, which problem is only hard or based on APSP, and which problems, maybe like those ones, are hard based both on Friesen and APSP hypothesis, and possibly on some other hypothesis too. So I think this gives us like a more complete landscape when we are able to say that, like, all those problems which for many years people were proving, like deriving their hardness based on triangle listing, thinking that what they actually do is they are establishing the hardness based on Friesen hypothesis, now it suddenly turns out that all those proofs are also valid as establishing the hardness based on APSP hypothesis. So if at least one of those hypotheses is true, then the hardness assumptions will hold. So that's, I think, a pretty optimistic way to end. And I welcome any questions.
Thank you. So I have at least two questions. Mm-hmm. One question is, this edge triangle counting, mm-hmm, is basically equivalent of the Hamming product in the query side.
Yeah.
Or equality product. It's the same, right?
Yeah.
So you could reinterpret other problems on the range query side as edge triangle problems. Are there any natural problems occurring there? Like,
I think I didn't think about it, but this is pretty interesting line of thought. I'm actually not sure for, like, inversions, it looks like a problem which is like very related to numbers, and many others from this class are too. So in that case, I believe there would not be such an easy equivalence like into the world of triangle counting. But maybe for some non-axis orthogonal piecewise polynomial functions, maybe we would be able to reinterpret it this way. Like, I'm not able to give you the answer, but I think that's an interesting question. But I think we haven't analyzed it that much except for like noticing this equivalence with the edge triangle counting.
Mm-hmm. And another question is, what is known about approximation algorithms for all of those problems? Like I want just a multiplicative approximation of number of range inversions or.
So I believe I would need to check. But
I think it's a more of an open-ended question here.
Yeah, I think I don't know the answer just like this, but I wish I like it because there are some proofs about approximating APSP, so in at the times when we were writing this paper and doing this research, we didn't know this, but now that we know that those problems have an assumption based on APSP, then maybe it would be interesting to analyze whether that anything about APSP can be translated. But of course, we need to remember that those are not tight equivalences. So we basically only can translate the assumptions about hardness from the APSP to our problems. So I'm not sure if we can directly translate something, but I would go into the APSP site probably searching for some approximations.
I'm motivating this question because in the upper rectangle that you have here, all of those equivalences between the functions, they break down if you are not in the exact world, but if you are in the approximate world.
Yeah.
I believe those are no longer equivalent, and specifically for some of those functions we have efficient approximation, and for some other functions we don't have efficient approximation. For example, we don't know how to approximate efficiently equality, but the complementary function of non-equality or Hamming distance, we know how to approximate efficiently. So I think trivially there is an efficient algorithm for approximating complements of triangles.
Yeah.
Like if you want to count the non-triangles, then you can trivially approximate this.
Yeah, I think that's cool because like this equivalence solves this for us. Yeah, I think there is no approximations known. Like I'm not actually sure if this is a good line of thought, but for example, like the problem of just detecting one triangle. It is hypothesized that it requires more than linear time to just detect a triangle in a graph. But this is just a hypothesis. This is not a proof that we cannot do this linearly. So maybe if we were able to devise an approximation for those problems, then maybe it would get somewhat contradictory with, because from the approximation we could probably be able to just check whether there is a triangle or not, but
I would be really surprised if there was a way to approximate triangle detection. I think you can approximate the complement of it, but not the detection. So you can detect that there is a triangle missing in your graph.
Yeah, probably. Yeah, like I said, I think the fact that we just know so little about just detecting whether there exists any triangle in the graph, it suggests to me that maybe approximating these more hard problems like edge triangle detection, it shouldn't be possible if we have problems even trying to detect one triangle in the whole graph. But yeah, I think you are right.
Okay, I don't have any more questions. Oleg or others?
I don't really think I have questions, but I like this approximation approach to this?
Yeah, that's an interesting question, but sadly, I don't know the answer.
I was curious about this bottom left arrow that you have, because it seems that triangle listing, the case when t equals m, should be not more difficult than t is bigger than m. But and I thought that we can include it into this equivalence, but I believe that the problem here is that we have different parameters for larger t, right?
The complexity for the triangle listing is like this. So basically, as long as t is smaller than m, then this is the relevant part. And when t is larger than m, then this part starts to be relevant. To see this more exactly, we can look at this simplified situation when omega is equal to. So then it simplifies to something like this. So so basically what our reduction says is that we are able to achieve this running time for any t from an algorithm solving this specific t equal m version in a black box manner. Like we not only want to say that we have an algorithm which solves those problems in this time, but like for any possible algorithm solving this case in this time complexity, we are able in the black box manner to translate it into this complexity for the general case. But of course, like the complexity matches this, and like it was not possible, of course, for us to create a better complexity because this would go against this lower bounds. So I'm not sure if this answers your question.
Well, I'm not sure because there happens too many terms in this complexity. But the next question would be, so if we improve the triangle listing for t equals m, and we have this reduction from t larger than m to t equals m, what would be the complexity for listing t triangles when t is larger than m?
It was also improved, but this will probably not happen because like those, this upper bound and this lower bound, they already match if omega is equal to. So this seems like, it's not impossible. What seems nearly impossible is improving the lower bound. The upper bound, maybe we would be able to improve it into like some complexity based also on the omega on triangle multiplication, which has those terms better. So like it doesn't violate the lower bound, but it just utilizes the matrix multiplication better. Like this would be possible. And in that case, we would see a similar speed up here. And what exactly is the speed up? Like we would just need to substitute those complexities into this equation, and then we will see what exactly is the speed up which we achieve compared to the current state of the research.
Really what I forgot.
Okay.
But yeah. True, you mentioned that. So, so this would be the better complexity.
Yeah. So, but like, as I said, like, I don't think all of this is very probable. Like, it looks like this complexity is more or less settled. Like, it's very improbable to improve any lower bounds from this, and it's highly unlikely to improve the upper bounds. Not as unlikely as improving lower bounds, but still pretty unlikely, I think. Okay, are there any other questions?
Okay, I think I can stop the recording.
Great, so thank you very much for your attention and for the invitation.